Thank you. and Thompson Park south of Butte. And so a joy for them to be with the youth, to be enjoying what it means to be away from here a little bit while at the same time practicing the practices that are going to be part of our life moving forward. Some announcements I want to mention to you real quick, just an awareness that this is a social justice action week. And what that means is we will be having...
I'm told that I'm on. No, no. Test.
Lots of options when it comes to doing church here. So we're going to try this way with a little different mic. As I said, Reverend Amy and Ann are camping in Butte with the youth, and so I know that they will indeed take your prayers for a hard night on the ground, but it is good to see the youth being out and about in the world in a way that is going to look different than it has looked before. Some special announcements we want to bring to your attention. We're going to have a Social Justice Action Week. Every day this week, there will be an action for you to take as it pertains to being in ministry around reconciling the racial injustices in our country. I invite you to turn to the Friday email that you received. It has all that information, but every day you'll receive a post on social media or the emails throughout the week will tell you what to do each day. Tomorrow we'll begin with a prayer vigil on Zoom at 7 p.m. That link will be sent out in tomorrow's email, but we want you, as you are able, to join us as we engage prayerfully the ways our country, our lives, our community is failing to be a reconciled part with everyone who lives together. So make sure you're aware of the ways you can be involved. Social Justice Action Week this week. There is a new app at Bozeman UMC. It has the bulletin information in it, as well as multitude of ways to connect. So if you look for that information, it is also in the Friday e-blast. But if you need some help figuring that out, just let us know. If you are joining us online, we'd love for you to take a moment and write out your comments or write out your prayers in the comments section so that we can be in relationship with you. We really, really want to connect with you in this way. We'll then lift those up during the prayer time so that we're all together receiving the prayers of this community. It's an important part of what it means to be church. If you don't have some communion elements, we're going to receive communion every Sunday in July. And so I invite you to make sure you have the elements, whatever they are for you, a coffee and donuts, cashews and orange juice, Hawaiian bread and grape juice. It doesn't matter. Whatever the elements are for you, I hope that you'll have those ready with you. Well, we had 1 week of on-site worship, and due to a constantly changing situation, we transitioned away from that this week. And so there is nobody gathered in the sanctuary this morning. Trust me, no one wants us to be back in this space more than I do, because it is incredibly difficult to do church when there's no one here. But as I said in my email to those who had signed up to be present, we have a responsibility to one another. We have a responsibility to lots of different constituents in our community and in our ministry. This isn't going to end anytime soon, the struggles we're having with COVID, but it will end. And so in the meantime, the question is, how will you find God? How will you make space for community in healthy, socially distanced ways? How will you strengthen your soul? How will you connect online with those you need to connect with? For many years, as a community, we've been having conversations about the intersection of justice and unity. And I think it's important we recognize that is not an easy conversation to have. Because if you stand up for justice, then at some point you're going to lose unity. But if you stand up for unity, we'll not actually follow God's justice all the time. I always ask the question of whose justice are we talking about when we use that word. There seems to be a competition sometimes about who has the worst justice or who needs justice better. And I wonder if we can prayerfully discern what's God's call for justice and what's human desire. What's equitable? What's fair? What's just? And our human desires might not match God's call for our lives. Can we recognize when that is the case? As we enter further into worship today, I hope that you have some great friends to have conversations with. I hope that you Zoom with them on a Friday night and dialogue about these questions. I hope you sit in a park, socially distanced, and ask these questions. I am happy to text with you and be in conversation around these questions if it's helpful. But you have to find your community during COVID. You have to make sure it engages your mind and your heart and your soul. The church is still here. We've never left. We've just shifted our methods of engagement. And as we do, I hope you're with us on the journey. Let us pray.
Jesus Christ, you come into our presence from many
And from these different places, we bring our songs of joy, we bring our shouts of gratitude, we carry heavy burdens, we bring sighs, suffering, exclusion, oppression, and marginalization. As we welcome you into our presence, and as you welcome us into your presence, lift our burdens. Salt us with your grace. Bind us together that we may be both people of resistance and people of peace as we go forth to serve you in the world. In your holy name we pray. Amen. I invite you to join us as we sing our hymn of celebration this morning. It is called Lift Every Voice and Sing. This is actually titled the Black National Anthem. It was written by two brothers in the early part of the 20th century. The words evoke for us the struggle of equality and for civil rights. I remember the first time I sang this song at a national convention, I had picked it as our processional song, the song that would lead the clergy into an event. And some of my colleagues, prayerfully, faithfully, and I am so thankful they did, said to me, "This is a song that we don't walk to. We actually stand and we are in reverence to the power it has for our lives and the way it speaks to our struggles." As you sing it, I invite you to note that there's not a single occurrence of a singular pronoun. They're all plural, indicating the shared experience of suffering and the shared struggle for justice. I invite you, as you are able, to stand and join singing. Every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring, ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Full of the faith that the dark past has brought us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of our shadowed beneath thy hand, may we forever stand true to our God, true to our native land.
Along with pictures of her precious daughters participating in at-home VBS, working in the garden and baking a pie, a member of our church posted the following on social media earlier this week. We have been able to find day-to-day fun in this beautiful place we live. I count my blessings every day and have so many, but these times are an emotional roller coaster for me. Which friends should we see? I wish we could see more friends. What should we be doing and not doing? Is it okay to run errands with my masked kids, or should I get a sitter? Camp was so good for my daughter a couple weeks ago, but it was quickly canceled. What will school look like this fall? How are parents gonna do this while working from home? Where is this pandemic going? What about my parents and my in-laws? I find myself forgetting for a while, but then there are so many reminders. This is a different time, friends. This is a different time. It is a time filled with so many questions, so many unknowns. It's a different time, and it's an anxious time. I would have never called myself a planner, but when you can't make any plans, or when plans are constantly changing, when you aren't sure what's safe, and you don't feel like you can count on anything, it can feel like anxiety runs through my body like speedy little microbes, making my blood and mind run faster than it's supposed to. Anxiety is the mind and body's reaction to stressful, dangerous, or unfamiliar situations. Doesn't it kind of feel like life is an unfamiliar situation right now? A certain level of anxiety is normal and it helps us be prepared and safe. But for those suffering from an anxiety disorder, it can feel far from normal and it can be debilitating. Anxiety disorders are actually the most common mental illness in the U.S. In 2018, 40 million adults over the age of 18, or 1 in 5 people, reported having more than what doctors would call expected daily anxiety. This is much higher than reports from previous decades, which has people wondering, why is anxiety in the U.S. on the rise? While increased stress to outperform peers, social media, chemical dependency, and of course our recent health stressors have certainly left their mark on our country's mental health, many researchers believe that we are simply more aware than previous generations. A fact I can certainly relate to, as I don't feel like anxiety was a word that I used as a child or even a teenager. I suppose that one could say that talking more about anxiety is a self-fulfilling prophecy, and so now there is more anxiety. But for me, talking more about anxiety has helped me to feel more equipped to keep moving through my day when my stomach feels like I have a job interview, even though I don't. Talking more about anxiety has helped me to feel like I can empower my daughter when she's feeling overwhelmed by trying something new. Talking more about anxiety has helped me to embrace techniques that are actually being taught to children right now, but that are actually really good for everyone. Take, for example, the 5-4-3-2-1 practice that Grover, of all people, teaches kids on NPR. Anya, another Sesame Street character, asks Grover when Corona is going to be over. Grover responds that he doesn't know, but that it's okay not to know things. And together, they play a game that helps them to think a little bit less about what's going to happen later on, and instead stay in the moment. You simply name 5 things you can see, 4 things you can touch, 3 things you can hear, 2 things that you can or you wish you could smell, and then finally 1 thing that you can or you wish you could taste. It may sound silly to be taking tips from a blue puppet, but I've found that using my senses to ground myself to the present can be a very helpful way to keep my anxiety at bay instead of allowing it to spiral out of control. As I've said before, practices like this don't make the unknowns known, but they will hopefully give our bodies a more centered place to walk towards the unknown from. The church member ended her post by reminding readers that we are adaptable, that we are strong, that she's finding daily blessings on the roller coaster, and that she's, of course, available for her friends that are struggling in these anxious times. We are adaptable because we are made in the image of God. God is adaptable. God created the earth, and then humans messed it up. God ruled the people with kings and judges and prophets, but none of that was working. The people and God made covenants, and then people break them time and time again. We say it during communion. When we turn away, God's love remains steadfast. We are strong because we are made in the image of God. God's love is stronger than any human can have the ability to even understand. Anxiety is real. And if you're experiencing symptoms that need medical attention, please know that Bozeman United Methodist Church will walk with you as you get help. And yet, for many of us, when we see God's creation around us, when we hear the sounds of children playing, when we feel our cool sheets after a hot day, or drink sun tea and taste a meal lovingly made for us by the staff where we live, we can take that microbe running through our body feeling, or however it is you feel anxiety, and remind it that when there are a lot of things that we don't know, there are a lot of things that we do know. The church emergency number is 406-333-1856, because this is a community that believes your mental health matters.
You to join us in singing our prayer song this morning.
There's a spirit of love in this place. There's a spirit of love in this place. You can't see it, but it's there, just as precious as the air. There's a spirit of love in this place. Oh, alleluia, sing alleluia. We bless your holy name. Oh, alleluia, sing alleluia. There's a spirit of love in this place.
As we turn to this time of prayer, I want to lift up some public prayer concerns that have been raised. First of all, we want to give thanks for the flowers on the altar today are given in memory of Martin Hathaway's mother, Jean. We want to lift up a celebration with Bill and Martha Hendricks on their 40th wedding anniversary. What a celebration and a day it is. We are overjoyed with you. Prayers for Kim Bowden's son, Adam, as he's starting basic training with the Army National Guard. Thank you for your service, Adam, and we will certainly be in prayer for you and with you. Dana Doney, travel mercies as she travels to Texas this week. Tanya Reinhardt asks for prayers for Aiden and fellow cadets as they head back to academics this week, as well as all students in college and all of our schools as they head into the unknowns. We pray for Margaret Brunn's cousin who has terminal cancer. We continue to pray for Patricia Cornelius' sister Carolyn, who is battling cancer, as well as a friend of the Cornelius' named Paul, who's battling COVID-19. Dan and Bev Wonder's granddaughter, Dr. Leanna Hansen, is caring for COVID-19 patients. And so we want to lift her and all those in our medical community, our essential workers who are on the front lines of this pandemic. Finally, we want to lift up prayers for our ministry partners in El Salvador, the ministry partners we have with the Sealaway community, as in the death of Flor Gonzalez. This is a partner, a person, if you've been to El Salvador, many of us have met, and so we want to be in prayer and recognize what a devastating loss this is for that community. I invite you into a time of silence, and then followed by prayer. Holy and gracious God, we give you thanks for friends, for life, for the blessings that we experience. In this time of pandemic, oh God, and the struggles of our lives, whatever they are, we need good friends now more than ever. So deliver us some good friends, some sojourners for the road of ahead. Friends who will ask hard questions but stay with you while you struggle with the answers. Friends who will see you at your worst but still love you. Friends who have plenty of practice forgiving you. Friends who have no illusions about who you are but still remain in relationship with you because you are a good, beloved child of God. Everyone needs a good friend. Everyone needs someone to walk the journey with us. So God of wisdom, God of justice, God of mercy, deliver us some friends and be ours too. We pray in the way our friend Jesus taught us so long ago. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we turn to our time of offering, there are a multitude of ways for you to give in this community of faith. And so we invite you to make sure if you send your checks this summer, we ask you to make sure they find their way here. We also want to make sure you know there are text to give options and online portals available at our website as well as through the app. Thank you for your giving. Thank you for the ways you contribute to this ministry that you allow for us to continue to have a presence in this community, both digitally but also on the ground with those in need. I invite us to turn to some special music this morning.
Join in song, the heart of the
Abby for that wonderful special music. Invite you to join us in singing our song of thanks. You to join us in celebrating Holy Communion by bringing God's presence closer to us. It doesn't matter what your elements are. What matters is that they are holy because we share them together. In this moment of pandemic, it's easy to disconnect from one another. It's easy not to see one another and think that the community isn't here. But it is because we share these elements that Christ is present between us. Beloved community was a phrase often used by Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King to reflect that we sit together in this community. And it's in that holy place that we allow one another to be challenged, to see the pain and the injustice and the hurt of another person. We are called to be a community that comes to the table together to affirm our differences and our connections. This is the kind of community that has not been found to be wanting. It's found to be hard. Let us sing. Community, we come to this table together, bringing with us our doubts and our losses, the wear and tear of pandemic. But we also carry with us the needs of our community and our personal struggles, financial struggles, resistance, fear. We gather as those who have committed ourselves to hoping for a new day where this change happens. We're invited to hold in our hands and in our hearts the love of God instead of fear, instead of anxiety. We are invited to embrace not only our unique messiness, but the messiness of the person who is in community with us, who also shares in the bread and the juice of Holy Communion. This day, may that truth of our connectedness be embraced, that we recognize the diversity of God is God's intention for our world. Let us sing.
Different, diverse, all unique, we're united in Christ. We have been made complete.
Beloved all together, beloved.
remember that night so long ago. We tell the story about Jesus gathering in a room with his friends, his family of choice, those who witnessed the highest highs and the lowest lows of his ministry. And they had a meal, and after the meal was over, Jesus took some bread and he broke it. And he said, "Take and eat, for this is my body broken for you." And after he'd done that, he took a cup and he held it up. It was a cup of wine that they weren't supposed to touch, but it was a cup that holds their dreams and their hopes for a world that was not yet there. And in the pain of the injustice around them, Jesus said, "But that injustice is not the way God dreams for our world and not the way it will always be. For receive of this cup my blood poured out for all of the world." Let us sing. Pour out your spirit, O Lord, upon these elements, on this bread and this cup, but upon this church, its leaders and its witnesses. This covenant is not for generations long ago. The promise is for us gathered together, those who are called Methodists of the Gallatin Valley. We promise, faithful God, to be open to your calling spirit, following your transformative journey. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, a beloved community and ministry with all the world. Amen. Let us sing. Receive whatever elements you have available. Receive the bread. Receive the cup. These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. May the bread of life and the cup of hope restore your soul during these challenging times. Amen.
This is our time. Everyone's welcome. We're here to shine. Jesus light on everyone. Lots of ways. Lots of days. Ba-da, ba-da, da, ba, ba-da.
Hey, everybody, my name is Abby, and I'm here with my friend
Bob, aka Gavin.
Gavin and
Alberto, also known as
Everett. So today, you guys, we're going to be talking about friends. So my first question I have for you is, what is a friend? Do you guys know what friends are?
Someone you hang out with.
Someone you hang
someone
out
you
with?
Hang
yeah.
Out with and someone that you're real cool.
Okay. Do you have friends?
Yes.
Yeah. Do you guys have a best friend? Who's your best friend?
His name's Bryce.
And why is he your best friend? Why did you pick Bryce? What do you like about him?
Because they both have glasses and they're both blue.
Oh. Hold on, hold on.
Well, we both have the same. Well, a lot. We're pretty much the same.
You're pretty much the same? Do you guys like the same stuff? Do you guys like to play the same games? Is there anything you guys don't have that's the same?
Parents.
Parents, like mom and dad? That's true, because you have the same parents as him, right? Is he your friend? On a good day?
Sometimes.
Kinda. What about you, Everett? Who is your best friend? This is tricky.
Myself.
Oh, okay. Why do you like yourself so much?
Because I'm exactly like my best friend.
That's fair. You are literally exactly the same as yourself. That's impressive. Okay, so here's my next question. Are you ready? What is it that makes somebody a good friend?
They help you if you're down.
Okay.
But if you're hurt, they say you're on a hike and
sure. Yeah, so if you get hurt and you're feeling down or you scrape your knee, your friends can help you and make you feel better. Yeah, and you said you have another friend, right? Who does what? Sure, he kind of like helps out, keeps the peace a little bit. Yeah. What about you? Do you ever have a fight with your friends? Do you ever have a fight with your brother?
Yes.
Talk about friendships. You guys know who Jesus is?
Yes.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Okay. So Jesus asks us to love everybody and love our neighbors. And sometimes, do you think that's easy or hard? Do you think it's easy or hard to be try and be a friend to everybody?
Hard.
You think it's hard? Why do you think it's hard?
Because some people don't exactly like how me, because I'm different than some people.
Sure. Yeah, that's absolutely right. Sometimes it's hard to be friends with other people because they're different, and sometimes it's hard to understand other people when they're different from us, right? Mm-hmm. But what does Jesus ask us to do?
Still be friends.
Still be friends and still love them, right? Because maybe Jesus loves us. And we know how it feels to be loved and have friends, right? And we can be good friends to other people, even though it's hard sometimes. Okay, Everett, tell me your best joke.
Doctor, I've got 59 seconds to live. 1 minute, please.
See you next week.
Next week.
Today's scripture reading is from James, chapter 4, verses 1 through 6. Now James, who is possibly Jesus' brother, is writing the text. He brings up some sort of struggle or conflict that was unfolding in his community. We don't know what the origins were, but the author is clear that though the conflict, God's grace is always present with us to be a unifying moment despite our disagreements. So what is the source of conflict among you? What is the source of your disputes? Don't they come from your cravings that are at war within your own lives? You long for something you don't have. So you commit murder. You are jealous for something you can't get. So you struggle and fight. You don't have because you don't ask. You ask and you don't have because you ask with evil intentions, to waste it on your own cravings. You're unfaithful people. Don't you know that friendship with the world means hostility towards God? So whoever wants to be the world's friend becomes God's enemy. Or do you suppose that scripture is meaningless? Doesn't God long for our faithfulness in the life he has given to us? But he gives us more grace. This is why it says, God stands against the proud, but favors the humble. This is a word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning, BUMC. Welcome to our continued conversation about faith and really big questions.
I'm joined by four others from Bozeman United Methodist Church, and I would like you all to introduce yourselves and share with us your favorite hymn or your favorite song that we have sung at BUMC.
I'll start. Dennis Downey. We have a lot of favorite hymns. Morning is Broken is one of my favorites.
The Cat Stevens version or any version of that?
Any version.
All right.
BUMC version.
The BUMC version. There you go.
My name is Brian from Rhine, and I like a lot of songs. In some hymns, I'm more of a modern music guy, I guess you might say. One of the songs I like a lot is "Build Your Kingdom." Mm-hmm. I like how it's rousing, and I like everything about it, really. So,
John Howe. My favorite hymn, I can't remember the exact name of it, but it's Lord, Listen to Your Children Pray. It's just a very simple, easy, and it's also a hymn I can remember to sing. That's mine.
My name is John Wilkinson, and you can probably tell from the hymn I picked that I'm the elder, I won't say statesman, but representative. It is Amazing Grace, but I also like the new version of that.
Uh-huh.
That is very good.
Uh-huh.
So,
yep.
I like that.
It is. It's got a little bit of a kick to it, right? All right. A few weeks ago, I preached about the challenge of how we balance unity and justice. And I think it becomes the challenge of, as we had named last week in our conversation, the power of this community, the power of community, that among our differences we can sit together. But at what point do we as a community say this is a value of ours, and then folks get to respond to that value and struggle to figure out how they're going to respond to that, how they're going to, can they be a part of a community when they don't agree with the value it has, especially when that value is related to an understanding of God's desire for justice in the world. And it's a hard, hard line, and so I'm just curious kind of where we all are with that.
My wife and I did struggle when we were initially considering LGBTQ mm-hmm. designation and how our church would respond. We both grew up in families that were strong supporters of that, mm-hmm. Being all inclusive. And so, but it came back to, we were talking last week about the men's group and a couple of the elder statesmen, as John mentioned, brought up some points that It's really the faith that binds us. We might not agree on individual aspects, but looking past that and saying, I value the human being sitting in front of me,
right.
Despite what we might disagree about, and that the love of Jesus and the love of one another, I think, is what transforms at least our ability to look past maybe some justice differences or issues that we might not agree with politically.
When I think about justice and unity, it's hard for me to understand how, when there are groups of people who suffer injustice, how you really come together to get unity out of that.
Mm-hmm.
I think you can have peace, mm-hmm. you know, you can agree to disagree, and you think coming to unity, and you think of it in a sense outside of church, and you have to have compromise, but can you compromise on justice? Mm-hmm. I don't know how to bring those two together myself.
Yeah, it's a hard struggle for me. I love the phrase. Let me rephrase this. I loathe the phrase. That's agree to disagree, and I loathe it because that's fine if it's ice cream, right? Like I said last week,
right.
Like you can like whatever ice cream you like, and I can agree and say that is the worst. I would never eat that ice cream. But when we're talking about someone who is oppressed or marginalized or treated differently because of nothing that they have chosen or because of just the lot that they were born into life with, that for me, I can't agree with that, right? Like there has to be that response.
And those people aren't going to care about unity without
right.
justice.
Right, exactly.
So,
exactly.
It's a tough spot.
It's so hard. It's so hard.
I personally think that justice is so important because in my younger years, I was a Sunday school teacher for quite a few years. And as such, I got to know the Bible pretty well. And when you read the Bible, you understand that God's heart is all about justice. I mean, every inch of the way. And I, when some of the things going on about the virus were concerned, and some people were talking about how they should open up churches and all of this, one pastor that I admire, he said, you know, as Christians, we're supposed to use our brain. And my brain tells me that God loves justice. Mm-hmm. And if God loves justice, I need to love it also.
Mm-hmm. And so to that point, it's how do we protect the vulnerable among us, right? Like, how is our lens not towards those of us who are privileged or blessed, but towards those of the, but towards those who are vulnerable and marginalized? How is that the lens for our decision making? Yeah. That is hard.
As the comic book would once say, Spider-Man, with great power comes great responsibility, right?
Thank you, Stan Lee.
Yes, Stan Lee. But I think that speaks to John's point of what Dennis was talking about earlier, right? I mean, it's those of us that have been given the opportunity to stand up need to do so, to speak for the vulnerable, people who don't have a voice, the oppressed, because often to what Dennis... they're not looking for unity. They're just looking to get by or to have some form of justice.
Right. Right.
It's our responsibility
right.
to help them
right.
achieve that.
Yeah, absolutely.
One of the reasons I value the church is that it's taught me that it's okay to not all agree about everything and still love one another and be together in a community. But to your point, there are some things that are kind of non-negotiables. And I know this is subjective, right? My non-negotiables may be different than other people's. But I believe strongly, you know, how this resonates within me, but also reading the Bible, valuing every life, it seems like it's pretty obvious that that's what we should do. I hope we can do that. You know, I try to. And
yeah.
I have my own struggles with things that I've grown up with, or biases, or whatever, that I'm not even aware of.
We all have those embedded biases, right? Whether it's institutional racism or systematic racism, familial racism, right, that we grew up with. We all have, I think a certain generation grew up with a different understanding of Scripture and the authority of Scripture than younger generations have grown up, right? It doesn't have, its location in history is judged differently than a different generation grew up with. And so, how can we take those embedded theologies and just really unpack them and go, what do I believe about this, right? What do I believe about God? What do I believe? Why do I believe Jesus came? What's the intention of this? I think those are the really hard questions to get to. I guess I come back to the are there values you find non-negotiable? I thought that was an interesting way to phrase that. Like, what would you say is non-negotiable?
I think it's non-negotiable that the only way justice can be achieved in this world is, whether it's the younger generation or the older generation, I think have to agree on one thing, and that is up to God's children, God's people, God's family to bring justice. Mm-hmm. That's the way He brings justice.
Mm-hmm.
And so that means it's up to me to help bring justice.
Right.
It's also up to my granddaughter
mm-hmm.
to help bring justice.
Yeah. I really appreciate that, because it also doesn't put it on God, right? We are God's agent. We can't just sit here and go, well, when you're ready, I'm ready, Jesus. Wait for that. You know, like, that doesn't work. That's not justice. We're called to actually do something, to your point. I really appreciate that. Yeah.
I think another thing is, are you doing it out of love? I know we've talked a lot in our Men's Bible, so the intent of something,
mm-hmm.
right? The intent of doing that is out of love, to love one another and to treat each other as I treat ourselves. I mean, if you just follow those two simple principles, you wouldn't have racism, you wouldn't have slavery. You know, you would look at someone who is different than you and say, hey, how can I love you? How can I help you along your way?
Mm-hmm.
Rather than try to figure out, like, how do I take advantage of this person
mm-hmm.
and calm them? Yeah.
That's tough. What's not negotiable? I mean, be kind first. That's that's where it starts for me. I mean, I can't even have a conversation with somebody if they're not kind.
Right.
And it goes back to the importance of church to me, too, because church gives you a safe place to, I guess, sort of stand on that pulpit over those justice issues. I mean, because we have to be safe, all
sure.
of us as well, right?
Sure.
You know, we all have families, and
right. Absolutely.
You can't put yourself at risk over that, but
right.
if you have other people backing you, you're a stronger force
sure.
and a bigger voice.
Yeah.
But be kind first.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I love that our bishop is a gay woman, right? Let's just cross off the check boxes,
right?
And I say that facetiously, but
right.
it's like, you know, to me that's a very powerful statement about
right.
being kind and saying
mm-hmm.
we embrace everybody, right?
We are
getting in this together, and irregardless of what your sexual orientation
sure.
may be, if you're a man, woman, the color of your skin.
You heard her preach?
Yeah.
She can preach. She can preach. Yeah. She is called. Absolutely. To your point about the bishop, Amy was visiting with a member of the community who left the church about 5 years ago because the bishop was elected. And, you know, Amy started to have this conversation with this person who kind of wants to come back into the community and really acknowledged, yeah, I think this person is called in a way I couldn't acknowledge before. So how do we, my non-negotiable is your no doesn't always have to be no. Right, we get to change our minds, and to that end, my absolute non-negotiable is an unwillingness to grow and change, or an unwillingness to be in dialogue and to consider. And to your point, Dennis, I mean, to be kind about the disagreement, but an unwillingness to sit down and go, yeah, this is a learning for me. You know, regardless of what it is, regardless of if I disagree with someone, it's a learning in how to be in dialogue with someone I disagree with at the minimum. Which is a learning how to be like Jesus, right? I mean, how to be more graceful with our lives. And so for me, that's when folks come and don't have that willingness to grow and learn and be in community, I just have very little space for that in my world. And that's hard.
Eric, I like the phrase that you and Amy have come to use, right? Let's hold the tension. Because I think that is important, to Dennis's point. Maybe not at least being open to the dialogue and saying, I might be wrong, or I'm open to a different way of thinking. Right? I think if you don't have that, then I have too many other things to worry about.
Right.
And to put my time elsewhere.
Exactly.
I mean, for me, the church showed me that it's okay to disagree and remain together.
Mm-hmm.
That was a transformative moment in my life.
Mm.
And I think a lot of people believe there must be 100% agreement with what you say and what I believe for me to be a part of something. And I don't believe that anymore. As long as the kind of higher level, you know, we believe that we should love each other and take care of each other and try to help each other. You know, those things are more important.
So last week we kind of touched on this idea of leaving church, right? And I absolutely want to hold for people when they come to a place where like, well, this isn't meeting my needs anymore. I need something different. You know, it's okay. I think people need to know it's okay to say that. It's okay to step in and out of churches as you need to. And yet at the same time, I this is an issue we hear people leaving the church over, right? On an inclusive spectrum and on a biblical tradition spectrum, right? It's not either or. I mean, we hear it from all kind of aspects. And I wonder what our response is to people who say, you know, I can't be part of the church anymore because of this issue, right? And it doesn't have to be LGBTQ. I'm speaking much more broadly, I guess, in a what it means to be in a healthy community. And not trying to judge that person's decision, but what's healthy and what's not is my question. I mean, do we think it's healthy to leave the church, to leave a community?
If the church has some fundamental values that are different, non-negotiable,
yep.
That's not,
yep. Yep.
It's not jabbing for you.
Yep.
I also believe that we're called to when we're challenged, that it doesn't mean we necessarily decide to step away from that challenge or that to stay and engage and wrestle. I mean, I think that's any meaningful relationship, whether it be a marriage or, you know, or a child or anything, you know.
I'm sorry.
That's the nature of it. You're not going to agree on a lot of everything and many. The more you care about it, the harder it can be, but it doesn't mean we step away necessarily.
Right. Necessarily. Yeah, I totally agree with that. And I think it's just, yeah, it's a struggle for me of are we willing to hold some tension, right? And as I said a couple weeks ago, there are a host of topics we all don't agree on, right? I mean, if we left because we disagreed over sports teams, right? I mean, there would be nobody left in church, right? And so that would be part of it. If I stood up and said, I actually don't care about the Bobcats, people get them to walk out, right? Like,
don't do that.
We're not gonna put that in.
I think one of God's most amazing characteristics is his grace. Mm. None of us, well, I shouldn't speak to the other four of you guys here, but I don't really deserve having a relationship with Jesus. I mean, I'm just not good enough. I mean, I just, too many things that, many of my thoughts, all of those things, but God gave me grace. He said, I know how you are. I know every secret about you, but I still mm-hmm. care for you. Mm-hmm. And I think on some of these questions that, like, I grew up very traditionally and believing every word of the Bible is true. Mm-hmm. And so that makes some of these decisions difficult for me. I have to kind of figure it out. Mm-hmm. But I've come to the point that I say the non-negotiable for me is caring for the poor, mm-hmm. caring for the least of these, caring for people that can't help themselves. Now, that's a non-negotiable. Mm-hmm. If a church doesn't do that, I could not be a part of it and I would leave. Mm-hmm. But as far as the question of that we've been talking about, I just give myself permission to say, God, when I get to heaven, I hope you'll answer that question for me, because I don't know the answer.
Yeah.
And but I'm okay as long as we're caring for the poor.
Yeah.
And as long as we're helping those people that can't help themselves, I'm okay just to keep joining in and joining the crowd.
Have you, John? I'm curious. Your connection to El Salvador is so great. Have you done a lot of reading around liberation theology, any reading around it?
Some of that, yes.
Some of that, yeah. That Catholic, you know, Oscar Romero coming out of El Salvador, right? But the idea of liberation theology is that God sits with the poor first. That those who are blessed and those who have privilege in this world are the wealthy, as that theology would name it, are not who God sits with first. God stands for the poor first. And it's a really interesting, that's a very simplistic way to frame it, absolutely, but it's a very interesting approach, and it certainly matches with what you're saying.
And I think when we come to the discussion in a few weeks on heaven and hell, mm-hmm. I have some things to talk about that, but I will save them for that discussion.
Yeah, wait. I love it. That's great. Thank you. Well, C.S. Lewis said that every act of justice involves putting yourselves in the other person's place, and this transcends our own competitive particularity. May you go into the world this week struggling to figure out how we embrace unity and yet how we also stand for justice. It's not an easy question, but it is one we are called to struggle with. Amen.
Next week, we will continue the conversation with a discussion about heaven and hell, and I think it's going to get hot on that patio. So hope you will join us to hear more of the dialogue of the big questions of faith that we struggle to answer. I want to let you know that the church office will be closed this week on Monday and Tuesday, as the staff is going to spend some intentional time figuring out how to plan for the fall. How do we do a hybrid ministry? And so I know we would all covet your prayers as we try to figure out how to be church in this disorienting time. I want to invite you to continue to struggle. I want to invite you to be in dialogue with some friends. But most importantly, I want to invite you to be faithful to justice in the tension with unity. Amen.
As your glory fills the sky, the valleys rise up and the mountains bow low, singing hallelujah. And so sings my soul with joy, and the anthem loud with resounding voice, and the stars beyond when the moon responds, singing hallelujah. So sings my soul with joy, and the anthem loud with resounding voice. Salvation made plain, and the way made straight. Singing hallelujah. Oh, sing hallelujah. Praise the Spirit, three in one. Oh, sing hallelujah. And so sings my soul rejoice, and the anthem loud with resounding voice. Lowly circumstance, swept up in your holy dance, singing hallelujah. And so sings my soul rejoice. Circumstance swept up in